Hey guys, good afternoon. Welcome to yet another series of the Art Talk. And as all of you know, the Art Talk series is organized by the Sneha Arts. And Sneha Arts is one of the leading art galleries in South India. And Dr. Snehalata Prasad is the director and the art collector. Every year she does a lot of events related to art. So today we have P. Gnana, artist P. Gnana, who is joining us from Singapore. And he is one passionate mechanical engineer who has become an artist, and he's well known for his paintings. He's also a sculptor. He's owner of a gallery out there in Singapore, and he's also a teacher. So apart from living his own passion of artist and creating his own creativity, he also believes that he should also take this forward and teach the art, so that the next generation is ready with it. So thanks a lot, Mr. Gnana, for taking time and joining us. So how did this passion start? How did this mechanical engineer, passionate person, get into artist, being an artist?
Vanakkam, Mr. Ravi. Before that, I'm pleased and honored to be in this session today. And thank you, Snehaji. Coming back to your question, art is always my passion. It's more than my passion, actually. So it was my childhood hobby, which I started, actually. Then slowly, I built in schools and college, wherever, whenever I do my whichever subject I do, art was there always. And it started from there like that, slowly I picked up.
Okay. So I really like the way you started with your mother tongue language, though you're in Singapore. So what made you do that?
It always there, right? It's something very, it's inside, always. Even we go any overseas, still I was working with the subject. If you see, my subject is cow. Cow is always my, subject which I used to paint or sculpt, actually. All the memories, whichever I missed in my life when I moved to overseas, actually. So it was there subconsciously, it comes very naturally. That's what I don't know, it's very natural for me. I don't like to force something, which let it happen as nature. When we start, it started like that when I come. It's a very casual thing, yes.
So how come from Tamil Nadu to Singapore? Why did you decide to move from Tamil Nadu to Singapore?
I was working as a quality engineer in Chennai for a private limited company, where we used to do a lot of precision instrument. Using precision instrument, I used to check the L&T shaft and sugar mills, power plantations and impellers, those type of works I used to use as a quality engineer. My manager used to advise me always, this is, you are very young, what you're doing here, you have to be explore more. And whenever you have lunch break, he used to always motivate me, talking about my career, and he used to express a lot of things to share his ideas. And he motivated me, why don't you go overseas? These are things you have to come at last and do this type of job. Now you have time, energy, you're young, you go and explore. So that always is in my mind, actually. And that's where I was trying to get a job. I applied and I got a job in a shell company in Singapore. Mm-hmm. And where I was the same quality engineer. I used to be there for the shell manufacturing Bukom in Singapore, actually. And in between, we have a break after a measurement as the quality engineer after 100. It's a drum, actually, the manufacturing drum company, where we have to check the quality control, everything is fine, everything. After that, we have a break every 1 hour. So even that 1 hour break, I used to do my sketches. So I warm up always doing sketch, creating artworks and always like that. And after sometimes I used to even weekend also in Sunday, I don't go for any movies or go with friends or anywhere else. I used to go to visit museum, galleries and also library, sit there and explore and read more about art. That is always there, even though I was working, but weekend also I don't, I fully concentrate more on art, actually. And one of the gallery in Singapore called London Fine Arts in Tudor Court in Orchard area. Mm-hmm. So he started my solo exhibition first, and he's the one who encouraged me to go on. Though I was in a self-taught that time while I was doing my solo in Singapore, then he's the one who asked me to go and see the LaSalle College of Arts, where I can get formal training. And that's where I went to LaSalle College of Arts and did my painting as a major.
Superb. So how do you choose the material? You're a sculptor. I've seen a couple of your arts where you've made life-size cows. So how do you choose the material for this?
Actually, I hunt materials, right? When I go and hunt for materials, I have certain ideas that time when I was choosing the materials. Maybe that time I would have been have an idea for this, for example, a Hero Honda tank or a bumper or two-wheeler, no, like bumpers or car parts or whatever. I just choose accordingly that moment. Maybe I have a certain idea. Okay, this part is going for the head or this is going for the body and like that. When I bring it to studio, when I'm going to start again the process in the studio, right, the entire program, the process will be changed. The material which I choose for certain place will be replaced for certain things. So it is not fixed actually. The ideas is not fixed. When I decided something and again come back to studio, the idea changes there. For me, like, no, I don't do any preliminary sketch or a pre-plan actually when I start my works. So I'll let go. So I just want to, not to be what you call like a restrict with certain ideas, no? I just want to be, for example, in same thing what you said, like that in painting also the same situation only. I sit in front of the canvas, plain canvas. I wait for right moment, no pre-planned sketch. I directly want to, pass the energy to the canvas like that. Even the mistakes or sketches, I overpainted there itself. I don't like to transfer my energy from sketchbook to again to the painting like that. Same way what just now you asked about the sculpture of the same things. So I decide something, when come back to studio, then studio process, entire process changes there.
I was going through your description and introduction which your wife has narrated. Very beautifully written, and out of the entire exhibitions, the art shows which you do, one of the things which was very touching was your childhood memories, where you were helping your mom milking the cow, finding the lost cow during monsoon.
Yes.
So I don't know the reason. I've never done this in the childhood. I regret that I missed this particular moment. So why do cows get lost during monsoon? And also, finding grass for it. I think these are some of the moments which, you have. I mean, those were beautifully described in this particular, the entire description. So can you talk about that part?
Yeah, actually, I love my mother very much, right? Usually, everybody the motherhood, that relationship is very bonding and strong, very strong actually. Same way like that, when my mother has feed cow, we used to have cow at my hometown where I was born in Neyveli, South India. I grown up there, and we used to have cow at my home, and I used to watch daily. My mother used to bring to feed the cow, and after that sometimes in the rainy time then we get to tie inside the shed, sometimes we bring it out. Those times daily, even though I was very young, I used to watch all those things, and somehow that when my mother is doing all the things, I'm very attached to her, and that also bring very close to the subject, the cow actually, because of my mother is, I'm very close to my mother, and mother is close to the cow, and again I'm very close to cow again, following her, whatever she's doing, I used to follow her, and I'm very, very close to animal, and in fact in childhood time also, I used to follow her in the veterinary doctor where you should go, because sometimes it's an excuse also, to cut the school, just go with her and not to go to school, all the things. So those type of things, I'm very close to that subject actually, which I'm doing now, cow actually, And also we worship cow. Cow is as a festival, Pongal festival in South India, where we celebrate, and in January we have August 15th or 16th, and 3-4 days we have that worship cow, and we decorate cow, and we thank for the the harvest festival, all those things. And we wait for that every year, to decorate the cow. At that time itself, I used to paint the horn and have some colors and put like garland with the colorful garlands and music and run together with it. That of childhood memory is very, very fresh. You have been bringing back me to another 40 years back now.
Yeah, because some of these things like milking the cow, some of the kids now, new generations, I've got exposed to it after like 20s. Anybody who's got this experience of milking the cow, seeing a cow giving birth to a baby, they are just blessed. I think with the urban life, we are slowly forgetting about some of these experiences.
Correct. Yeah. So. And that's what I want to bring back, those memories in my painting also. That's one of the reason also. And I was painting more on relationship, basically more on human beings. But all of a sudden, one day, cow appears in my paintings. I was very, I don't know why, I didn't force myself to, bring my memories there. But somehow, subconsciously, it was appearing in my paintings. And I couldn't realize why, actually. That's where my wife, Vidya Gaurisan Nayar, she is a curator. So, and she's the one who also bring back these memories to me and recognize to me to think that, maybe your childhood is memories coming back in your paintings. That's what, she wrote very, after, she met my mom and she interviewed her. And that's where the book has been created. And after the interview, my mother was giving all this, like how I was very close to cow and how affectionate with a cow, all those things. And she was explaining to her. And that's the reason also, one of the reason, the affectionate was there.
So what were the feedback from your mother? She has seen you being around her while she was helping her. But what was the feeling after she saw you replicating this entire experience in canvas? What did she say?
She was very happy, actually. Because earlier day, right, as a parent, they like to be as an artist, to be me as an artist. That was there, actually. But somehow, when I was slowly showing my process and the progress in my life, like artists can be also like success in their life, not to be, always. Because in India, all the parents, they like to be the children to be a doctor or engineer or other professional field, not be not like an artist, because those days artists has been shown in a way that they were struggling artists only, right? Yes. So that type of that was there, actually, in my in fact my father and mother was felt when I called them and said that I'm going to take as my professional again, I'm going for a college to study in art. They didn't like it initially, but slowly I was there to show them, like artists is in a different angle, actually. Though, to be very frank, if I'm in India as an artist, still I would have been not recognized like how I've been recognized in Singapore. Because Singapore is a very, not that big as, like India. So competition-wise also, it is not that much, actually. But though Indian community is very less, small here, and I was doing a major in painting. After that, I started my gallery. So easy for me to recognize also, to reach. Even Singapore Art Museum collected my collection, and ex-president S.R. Nathan also having in my painting in Istana House. So those type of link has been got. I am in Singapore, that's one of the reason I was blessed to be here, and it reach out. That's way I can say that, I won't say as a successful artist, I can say as an artist that I have been known very well in Lion City. And also after seeing that, my parents also felt that, he is doing something, not like, what we thought, but he moved in different direction, but in a good way. And they accepted that and they were happy. And my mother was very happy because I was doing the same subject of, the cow, which was which I was very close to her, and with the animal, with the cow, all those things was, it bring her also her memories, like my child, when I was child, how I was there. Now I'm connected with the same subject, I'm living with that and painting with that. Those type of things is also, she was very happy to know that.
So how do you describe, being recognized as an artist, how do you describe a great artist and the art which they make?
Actually, I don't say like to be a great artist, because when you want to be a great artist, you are been fixed yourself. So your style has been fixed. The viewers has been already like expecting something what like great artists you already done. So you will be in the same circle, actually, so you won't be moving out. So probably I like to be an artist. So the reason why is, if I'm an artist, I like to be to go for something, like new always, to experiment and explore new things always. If you are fixed already, you're a great artist, right? Mm. So you will be already, your style will be, the collectors or the viewers will be expecting the same style, because you have got the name, you got the success, you will be selling. like a few thousands every month because you are an artist, you're recognized as a great artist. But when I want to come out from that, you know, zone, comfort zone, I want to go beyond, like not to be fixed with a certain style also. I want to experiment a lot. And I want to go to the territory mm-hmm. where I didn't go before. That means not the, you know, the place where I want to be challenge myself also. To not to be comfortable always, no, to like, okay, I do canvas, I do the same subject. Okay, every series of the same subject I want to continue because though I am selling, I don't want to be continue the same series. So that's one of the reason I want to be an artist, not to be a great artist also.
So what style you follow and, you know, when was the U-turn for you to, you know, get into, you know, sculpturing or, you know, getting into, you know, doing a life-size cow? When did you decide all this?
Actually, my turning point was when I was in Singapore, mm-hmm. because after I did my graduation in LaSalle College of Arts and major in painting, because sculpture was my elective subject, not as a major actually. So my lecturer was giving a challenging to me that, you know, always, you know, I was doing a semi-figurative in my paintings based on relationship theme. To express my feelings or using more colors, all the things. But my lecturer was abstract painter who was my head of the department, Mr. Ian Wu. So he was challenging me, why don't you remove your figures and whatever you want to express, try to express without figures. How do you do? You know, go and read about this particular artist like Andre Masson, Jackson Pollock and Poet Mandrin. Those abstract artist masters, he gave us a reference, asked me to go and read about him. Then it was challenging for me also, how to express our feeling without, you know, like showing the figures, you know, like relationship, mother and child or whatever, husband, wife or lovers, whatever concept is there. I used to do a semi-figurative, not realistic, but semi-figurative to show the expression feeling. But how to show those same expression without figures, that was challenging for me. And I read about those masters who all he gave as a reference. And that's where, you know, like slowly I was trying to minimalize to my figures in my paintings and try to use more textures and tones and colors. And you know, the texture is very, very, the background, the texture is a very important. Most of the artists doesn't give more importance to the background, especially for the textures. Right. So textures has something very special and spiritual things. I feel as an artist, for me, especially like more than the subject, the background, the texture is important rather than the subject, what I'm going to create. Because I sometimes give very more important to the background than the subject also. In a way that that's the where I try to express my feeling and texture, and eventually I found something which collectors or viewers are more, they can feel that expressions and feelings in the background and the textures when I remove figures. That's what I moved from semi-figurative to the abstract. So abstract is again is very challenging and also it's not that easy. Like it, when I start the painting also in the studio, when I go to studio, I don't pre-plan when I start my artworks. No, I just wait for the right moment and I start. Sometimes I follow the dripping. I'll just go with the dripping and I'll start. No, I need a good start. When I got that good start, I just follow that, you know, what's happening in that moment. So I don't control myself. Sometimes I, you know, go with the dripping. Sometimes I stop there. Sometimes I control, you know, that. I connect with the painting myself, to and fro things like in there, not there, visible, not visible. Sometimes I leave the visible things. Sometimes I, overpaint the invisible things. I bring the invisible things and sometimes I hide the window. No, those type of things, no, there, not there, keep it, not keep it, no, keeping like that of illusion things and not to be concluded with, you know, because when you decided to, you want to do right, I won't be enjoying actually. So I don't want to have that the end result. I like to go with that moment, the process. So that gives a lot of things, no, like accident of, you know, pouring and ink drippings and changing of colors and that type of unexpected things. I'm more into that. So in fact, I'm searching something in that painting, no, which I like it more. Rather than I have something like, okay, this is the one I'm going to paint. I don't want to fix like that as in my paintings to, do that, the end product I don't worry about the end product. Whatever it happen, let it happen. No? I'm not worried about how perfect or how good the paint is going to be come out. That is different. That I leave it to viewers to decide whether they're liking or not, or how they're going to react to the end product. Is not that is not my thing which I more into it. I'm out of I just want to be out of that boundary, right? To do more experimental things and do a lot of things and accident things like dripping and pouring techniques and removing, creating the textures and removing the texture and layer by layer adding the textures. So all those things is more I'm more interested in it, and I'm in search of those path actually in that journey. Rather than have something photograph and tell that this is the one I'm going to paint and I want to go and complete this painting. So I'm out of that actually, to be very frank.
Got you. So behind every man's success, there are women involved. So who is the person who is behind your success?
That goes without saying. It's my wife, Vidya Gavaris, and actually. So I met her in Singapore, and to be very honest, and she's the one who fine-tuned also that turning point when I come out after my lecturer, I have to say Vidya, because we both started this gallery called Jnani Arts Private Limited, and all my paintings, she's the one who in fact give titles and write about my, in fact she knows to be very honest, better than me, she knows better actually in my creations, what I'm creating. Sometimes I don't know how to express what I create also, which I don't like also. As an artist, I don't like to give more explanation of my artworks to the viewers. Allow the viewers to engage and be in part of my painting. But as a curator, as a professional, she writes more about my artworks and give a lot of what you call impact and value to bring up my paintings. And the turning point is again with my wife.
Superb. So did you have a career which was like very smooth, or did you have struggles in between?
Of course, every artist has that up and downs. That definitely artists actually here, being in a human being itself, tough, and being in a human being as an artist again, it's an adding some more things. It's not that easy, but I have to say I have been blessed actually to to be an artist and be in as a again like known artist actually to be in a real artist. So successful artist, I don't want to say that word successful artist, because I don't want to be, I used to be a successful artist, but I don't want to be now as a successful artist. The reason is I want to come out from the zone which I created actually, to be, to reach and find out and explore a lot of things. So that's the reason I'm moving out, and not to repeat or do the same subject what I'm doing actually. So yeah, that's, as I said, it really I'm blessed to be as an artist actually, though there was an ups and down, but we managed very well, and we both are in the same field, and additionally we run a gallery as a full-time artist. If I'm only as an artist, it will be really tough, because artists actually, you have to be a successful artist. You have to be a successful artist, again as I said, right, you have to be ready to sell, and you have to be compromised actually, because what the collectors and viewers are expecting, we have to do. And we have to focus on the selling part. When you focus on the selling point, a lot of things you have to compromise. So as I said, right, the same subject, whatever works, red color painting is sell, then you have to create red. Because commercially you want to be successful, you have a family, you have things to buy art materials, a lot of things there to be, as an artist, you have to be, make sure everything goes smooth. So when we thinking about money matter, right, money, we need money to do all those things, then the subject, we are compromising there. The compromise means we know, especially me as a gallery owner, I know what is the collector's expectation when they come to the gallery, right, when they visit, and what they like, what they're expecting, all those things. When I'm directly, that's the reason I told I was blessed, because I'm myself an artist and gallerist. So the gallerist helpful, it was very much helpful for me for my artist career, because when the collector come and visit the gallery, right, I can visually see what is there, where the eyes going, and which painting they're looking at, why they're buying that painting, and what's the reason, all those things. So I'm very close, and I'm directly connected with the collectors and get all this information, which I am trying to implement all those ideas in my paintings. Even when I go art fairs, I know which country, which art fair, the works can sell, what type of works can sell. I can create artworks like that. And I have to do sometimes because, you know, right, paying for the art fairs and travelings and come back, you have to pay for the rental and family or things. But I'm very comfortable that I know which type of colors and especially which country, which colors and which type of size can go. So we have to, sometimes we are in that, comfort zone to create artworks. So when we don't have this commitment, right, then the challenging is there. I want to be in that challenge now. That's the reason I want to bring out. I don't want to be, yes, I am a successful artist, but I am no more. I don't want to be as a successful. I want to be an artist now to come out from this comfort zone, create what I like. As I said, like that process, it happened then and there. Don't plan something which can buyers can, what is the buyer's interest and create something like that. Come out from that and be an artist and enjoy.
Superb. Thank you. We have some compliments rolling in. There are a lot of audience who are watching this particular show. There are some compliments in Tamil. So unfortunately, I don't know to read Tamil. But, I guess these are not questions. But we do have some questions coming up. But before we move on to the question, I want to show the viewers of a couple of artworks which Mr. Gnana has made so that you'll have an idea. So this is a short movie of 1 minute, which covers almost everything which he has accomplished, which he has created in this particular world. So, few seconds, guys. Okay, welcome back, friends. So, very nice journey. I mean, some of them have like taken us to different directions, and we entered with the horse series. And before we talk about some of these series, you have a lot of compliments coming in from the viewers. A lot of them are saying hi, sir. And there is also a compliment from Mr. Prem Singh. He's saying good to see an artist who is humble and the same time very articulative. And we also have one question from Mr. Prem Singh. When do you think a painting is complete?
Thank you, Prem Singh, Mr. Prem Singh, for your wishes. It's a very tough question, difficult question to ask. When do you think your painting is finished, actually? Actually, to be, like as I said, right, so my paintings, if you're, I don't complete like that. Even though I sign my paintings, I'll come back after 2 years or 3 years and I'll do something which will, because as I said, right, my paintings and myself have that dialogue. A lot of dialogue is there. So, as I said, I didn't have any pre-plan and pre-sketch. When the process started, I go with the process and the flow. maybe at the moment I would have thought that, no, this is the where I want to stop it and sign it. After 1 year or 2 years, come back and I see that paintings, it invite me again. You know, we have that dialogue where I left, right, where I stopped there, and it's coming back to me again, and we have some interaction with again, you know, to go further to the next level or next, you know, the journey continues also. So most of the time, even my friends, artists like, you know, Mr. Viswam and Mr. Subra and other artists, all we used to be in the camp, you know, in Delhi, you know, and Noida actually with Akshay, my friend, usually organize a camp. So there they used to make, like, you know, they used to tell Jnana, you always, the painting is incomplete when you are going to complete like that. Yeah, for me, I want to not to be complete, actually, you know, I want to have that, let it go with that. Whenever I feel like, you know, it's inviting me, and I joined again with that flow and go with the flow, actually, you know, to go with, you know, from there where I stopped, and again, I go for the next flow. So that's the reason. Even that Zoom section, somebody made fun of us, right? How about even the collectors buy and went, then how you're going to do if you see in a collector's place when day you go there?
Good question.
I said, yeah, I will still, if he allows me, I'll do something to, you know, to complete it. You know, incomplete can be complete there also. For me, like, painting is not completed, actually, to be very frank. So still, I'll like to join with the, you know, whenever it invites me, so I'll just go with the flow. Sorry, it's my own thoughts and feelings, actually. Maybe I, Mr. Prem Singh, whether I say he's accepting or not, but just want to share.
Yeah, but whoever asked that question is a very, very nice way of asking that question. You know, what if the painting is sold? You know, how would you manage that? Yes, the next question from the same Mr. Prem Singh, how are you balancing between painting and marketing? Because both are specialities of its own, different fields altogether.
Yeah, it's actually, it's really tough, actually, you know, which I don't like it to do both together, because we won't be, you know, give that the impact as an artist, what you want to do. Sometimes an artist himself will be the marketing person for him, his or her own artworks. Like I like Anish Kapoor. He doesn't need any curator. He himself a curator for his own sculpture, no? The sculpture, which I admire him, actually. So some, they have the talent and ability to, you know, to market themselves for their own artworks as an to artists themselves to promote. For me, again, I was having a gallery which is take part, you know, it took that I didn't what you call like separately, I didn't have any other, you know, one disadvantage is there and disadvantage also there to have a gallery, because if you have a gallery, you yourself only can do promote, no other galleries will be ready to promote, because you already have a competitor, no, you have a gallery yourself. So I am in part of my own gallery. I can't go and approach any other gallery in Singapore to promote myself. Why should they do? Because I'm in, I'm myself in a gallery, and they're going to promote again, they're going to come back to me. The collectors are going to know me, where I am, then they're going to reach me and, you know, get the artworks, because it's not fair for other gallery to do. But no choice, I have to promote myself. I have to do marketing and, you know, use social media and also, you know, like magazines and because we build enough clientele. That's where we used to go for the art fairs also, where we get new clientele over than art fairs, and especially international art fairs. You know, we'll get a lot of new clients apart from our own regular clients, which we have already in Singapore. So we have to go for, you have to reach out to those countries and art fairs and exhibitions, take part, and we have to promote ourselves. No other choice. But marketing yourself is very, very important for the artist, no, to be an artist, because you also, there's a, again, if you're a very good artist, gallery definitely look for you if your artwork is very good. So if you want to be, you know, seen in the art scene, first you have to be different from others. Like what others, you know, like you can't do something like the same of like 20, 30 artists already doing in India or whatever. So you have to come out from that and show in art world that, you know, you are something unique and something special, which nobody has been touched this subject, and you are an outstanding. That's where the gallery will be more interested and they'll be looking for you. But again, how do they know that you are doing something unique? That's where the question mark starts again. No, we have to be also known to the, you know, galleries first, right? Before that, that we are doing something different. For that, again, we have to be tied up with, again, you know, like we have to go to the market, no, where the international art fairs and do a solo project, and you know where the galleries will be there, 150, 100, 200 galleries will be there. That's where they'll, you know, we have to be as a solo. We can't put the, our works in with a group of like 2-3 works where we will be, you know, lost there. So once we are ready that we are with outstanding artworks and we are unique and we have a something special style with us, and you know where we want to show to the art world, then we are in the art scene. And we have to be, you know, focus ourselves in a better way as a solo project. And that's where the gallery will contact us and approach us. And we have to be their market like that only.
Good. Now, you were talking about the camp, your friends, your close friends like Vishwam sir, etc. So what happens, apart from talking about art, what happens in the camp after the work is done or the gallery display is done? What happens? How do you
actually, all of the friends actually, enjoy? I have to tell this interesting story. Once Snake Lata ji has organized one in Goa, actually, international camp, which I was been invited to be in that part of that camp, actually. Snega was telling that, no, I don't want your painting, why don't you do the sculpture? I said, how to do sculpture in 2 days? Because I'm coming for 2 days there, and it's very difficult to concentrate on a subject, on a sculpture. And no, I'm getting some assistant for you from Jodhpur. He will be there with the clay, and we fixed all the clay, what type of quality. I don't know the quality also, how it's going to be. No, don't worry about that. He's a professional person who knows about the sculpture. He will bring all the clay, you just come, you know, like 2 days. And I reached there, again, there's, you know, all our artists were there, you know, with, like Veera Santanam is no more here, and Mr. Viswam and Mr. Manogaran and Mr. JK, all those artists were there. And they all were doing paintings, and they arranged for me all the setup, everything on that day. And I reached evening, if I'm not wrong, and the night, whole day, one night, we started continuously, and Snega was also watching the entire program. So we built a skeleton there and started to work with the clay. And it was a larger than life size female figure, which I started there. And that energy and that, what you call that, the completion was very, which I didn't expect actually, that speed we can go, I can go to reach, to, you know, to complete the larger than life size figure. And I did it actually with the clay. And that was quite interesting. After that, and we, you know, sit and discuss, you know, it was a lot of things to learn from those masters also, you know, which when we, all the artists joined together after the camp, session is over or completion, like a evening time, we sit and chat with and get and share experience. And because those masters and senior artists, you know, they have a lot of experience in that art field, which we'll talk each other and we'll get ideas. And also good to go with those camp and join with other artists also to exchange our ideas and our concept and share some technical aspects. In fact, with the sculpture or whatever medium you're using, like get their ideas. Because sometimes we don't meet others, we think it's correct and we do the same mistake. It's a mistake which we'll be keep on doing ourselves. When we sit and discuss with them or watch the other artists or other masters doing, then they may be using the same technique which we thought it's right. In other way, it's very simple. And the way of drying, for example, simple technique like fast drying in oil paintings. So we may get something ready-made things we read in internet and find, add this oil and we'll mix it and it'll fast, get dry faster like that. But practically and experientially, that which we won't be able to learn anywhere else. Only that, practically the person, the seniority or an experienced person can share. Which those ideas all, like for example, I'm telling, those ideas all comes when we are with us, with a group of artists and, share with the experienced artists and get their ideas and opinions, good always.
So no fun. It's all about challenging each other, learning from each other.
No. Fun is there. It's up to artists how much they are want to be. For example, when we artists are there, which we go for other international camp also. So after that, always there is an what you call music, dance, drinking, all those things. It's up to artists how much they want to be part of that, or whether I know some artists are after that they'll just go with their own. Thought they will take Facebook or search in messages or something like that. Some they won't like to be in part of loud music. Some they like to be part of a drinking session. No, it's all like it's nothing like it's very free. It's up to
individual
each and
choices.
every artist who want to be, how they want to be enjoying that. But always is there.
Okay, tell me, Mr. Gnana, don't you feel, I would say, jealous or you know, insecure or competitive, because all of you in a camp are artists, okay? Nowadays, you know, if you know, I have a Facebook, I'm an artist, I have a Facebook. I say one of my friend is creating a Facebook, another page, who, you know, and starts, you know, doing, becoming an artist and, you know, starts paying. I feel very jealous. I mean, this has become a very common thing nowadays with everybody. So, with the seniority you have, I'm sure each one of you have your own style. Don't you feel jealous or competitive when you're all together, you know, in a camp?
Yeah, actually, more than jealous, actually, you know, there must be healthy jealous, actually, I have to say, not to be like jealous in other way that he's doing, you know, like he can finish it faster, but my style, I can take only one day to complete, but he can do in 1 hour. It's, you know, we can't think like that. But there is something like where we should have an artist, we should always think that I must be better than him or her. Now, whenever we do the camp, you know, that always that feeling must be there within a sectional artist, you know, to say, like, for example, when myself and Mr. Biswam is there in the camp, so when I take a big huge canvas, immediately he will also have inside by big canvas, but indirectly we will have that, no, like, you know, yeah, I'm also coming, you know, we'll see who like that, but we won't say, but it is a healthy thing, no, like, but we have that
competition,
no, feelings that okay how fast he's going to finish, whether I'm going to take a long time or he's going to finish, it will be there always, which I think it we need as an artist, we should have, but we should be not to be as an like follow the same. But we have to be somehow I like to be different, you know, as an artist, everybody must be different from, you know, each other. So whatever they do, whether in the music or dance or a painting or a sculpture, whatever. So we have to be somewhere outstanding than others. That way I have to think always, you know, even when I visit the art fairs, after setting up my booth, Sneha also must know, she was in Singapore. So when we set up all the, you know, the fairs and hanging all our artworks, I used to go one round to see what's happening, the entire booth, you know, like maybe 100 booth or 80 booths, whatever. I used to go, complete to go each booth. And I sometimes when I pass by, certain piece only will hold me to stand for a while. So I'll be going just, you know, I don't go enter one booth like that. It's just passing by. Somewhere something will stop me. And that will be disturbed the whole day for me, you know. Like that's where that type of, you know, sometimes that will be disturbing me because which I didn't expect that piece to be there. Or something will be better than mine, what I'm doing. You know, that we have to be affected with all those things. You know, we can't say always I'm, you know, I am good actually, I can do better than, you know, those artists or anything. But always we have to see what's happening in the art scene, what is happening in the art world, right? So when we go that type of holdness, something is holding me, I really appreciate that artist. And that's where I go near and check who is the artist and from which country, what he does, how he does like that. So we all must, you know, have something like that. Go around, see what's happening in the art scene, and also no need to be jealous. Actually, you know, we have to be see that somebody is doing, you know, better than thing. Then I have to come back and see next year how better I can be from that artist, in whether in the size wise or, you know, like in the medium or in the, you know, the color or whatever he used. I have to see. I have to. That will affect me. You know, the disturb means I can't sleep is because I must think that I have to be something better than him or her. In my, you know, and then the field what I'm doing. So that way we have to always have to go ahead, and no need to be jealous in that way, and we have to be, you know, seen healthy.
Yeah, in sales, like we were talking about, as Mr. Prem Singh asked, you know, two different fields. In sales, when it comes to artists, and you know, we have a lot of audience who are artists right now who are watching this particular show. Do you suggest people should talk bad about somebody else's art just because they have to push, you know, their art to the customer, saying that my art is good, that art is, that painting will not last long, or, you know, that is just a copy? Do you recommend this negative talk about the other artist or his work because you have want to push your art?
Good question, actually. So actually we know, collectors, they know we no need to even whatever you push or whatever is sell, we are telling to the collectors, right? This artist is, you know, like finished very fast or not unfinished, you know, like that or something like that. But the buyers, the collectors, they're also an artist themselves, you know, in a way they know which,
they know.
How many times they would have been this artist, been, you know, would have put for the, create this, how texture, how thick the colors, everything is, they know, they do the research actually, because they're not first time buyers. I'm talking about serious art collectors. So some, there are two type of collectors. One, they come for art first, they don't ask who is the artist. They like it, they buy. They don't know, they don't want to know about artists also. They don't ask even certificate or authenticity certificate or whatever. Because they want to match the sofa, you know, the interior design, they like it, they have the budget, they go for that and they go, you know, they buy it, that's it. There are the another art collectors, very important art collectors, which we have to be, you know, we have to target those type of collectors. They come and study the artist, you know. They first time, first year, they follow the artist, how serious he is, whether he's changing his style or he's going with the same series of what he did last year. They would have been come, for example, like 2019, they would have been visited the fair. They were observing the artist first, you know, what they don't buy immediately. They want to see how artist is, you know, going in this art scene, whether he is still, you know, continuously working or, you know, doing, creating artworks, all the things. 2020, they come back and see the same artist. What is the development, how is the journey, everything. Seriously, they will watch all those things. That's where then they started to collect actually. And those collectors, we don't need to tell even, no? Like they want to ask, they will ask, no, like where is the artist from, that type of things. Technical part, they don't like to even, they don't ask the galleries to explain also, because they themselves know already what is, no, what's a good or bad. I like to share this small example. When you ask this question, I want to share this experience which I had previously. So once we did an art fair in Malaysia, there was a few artists we have been joined together and went to Malaysia to do an art fair. There was a beginner artist also included in that together with this mixed of artists group actually. And actually each artist were submitting two artworks to display there. And when we all displaying the artworks, some of the participant artists in that group, same group, and they were asking me, sir, why you add this artist, no, this next to us, you're putting next to us artworks, it seems to be, you know, not that what you call like a strength or a balance or whatever they feel in negative way they were saying actually. It's a program, you know, so we are today, for example, this evening is a VIP night. They were asking the day when we displayed, the same day was a VIP night. And program started, VIP all were inside the booth, you know, the art fair. When they were passing by, the first piece to sell was the amateur work, which they said is not good. That's the work was being sold in the booth, the very first piece. And everybody was shocked to know. Because collectors, sometimes we don't know what they like also, right? Maybe we think that it's not you know, standard or up to standard or whatever. But in art fair, it's not an exhibition. Exhibition is totally different in a you know, gallery, but in the art fair, for each and every piece, there is someone to buy. There are someone to be, you know, to choose that work. Actually, we don't know which work will sell first or which will be, you know, won't sell, or we can't judge like that. They come, they have with a certain budget, they may have certain ideas, they like it, they'll buy. They don't, that's what I was telling, they don't ask even who is the artist. They like it, they buy, that's it.
Thank you for answering that. So we have some more questions coming in from the audience. So, yeah, there are a lot of compliments in terms of when we displayed the artwork. Beautiful work, sir, from Sunita Agarwal. Manpreet says it's wonderful. Kranti KN says it's excellent, sir.
Thank you, everybody.
Okay. Renu Shukla says there is so much of depth and emotion in all your paintings, sir. That's the thing.
Thank you.
And sir, this is from Renu Shukla. Sir, may we know your upcoming plans for the next 5 years? Renu Shukla is asking this particular.
I don't plan for long actually, but we used to plan for a 2 years project usually for in a gallery. Again, 2 year plan is for basically more on art fairs. You know, we just go 6 or 7 countries, starting from Singapore, then Malaysia, Hong Kong, Dubai, India, you know, like 5 or 6 countries. That will be planned for 2 years ahead. Apart from that, in gallery, we used to have a 1 year project plan, like 3 months once, or like group shows and solo exhibitions like that. For currently, Now we the big project is for Maestro Ilaiyaraaja from South India. He's a well-known music director. We are planning a big project with him. He's an apart from the music, he's also a well-known. His hobby is taking photograph, taking photos.
Oh, okay. And I didn't know that. So
yeah, he does a lot of photographs, and last 40 years his photos all we have, and we are Vidya is curating that show soon. So that will be the major project which we are planning. And apart from that, again, if it's COVID, everything is over, then I'll be back to my studio in South India, and also in Delhi, both places where I have a studio. So I'll be creating more on life-size sculptures, recycled materials. So that will be my own project. Apart from that, the artists were planning some shows after the COVID-19.
I know Indian art is pretty famous across the world, but how was it selling in Singapore? You know, you're representing Indian art in Singapore for India. So how was the feeling, and you know, you feel there's a good traction for it out there?
Yeah, of course, Singapore market is very good. That's why in Asia, a lot of countries focusing on Singapore to be an art hub. And a lot of auction houses there, international art fairs are coming back to Singapore, and collector wise a lot of good collectors, and also nearby countries, Malaysia and Indonesia, so a lot of collectors come over here to collect in auctions, to buy the artworks. Singapore market is very good, and we also promoting Indian art for past 20 years now, and we have our own clientele. And whenever we do a shows, and a lot of our regular clients and become as friends also, they support always and they buy Indian art. And overall, Indian art in Singapore is good.
Who's your main inspiration?
Inspiration is within me, actually. No, and also nature. No, nature is my main inspiration, actually. I get from ideas, everything in nature, because everything is there in nature, actually. Even like my paintings, I used to do a lot of textures, which I said just now, I'm mentioning you about my using a lot of textures. I get inspired from nature only. No, I see a lot of the old walls and the water dripping there, and those type of dripping techniques. All I got it from there only, actually. Whenever I pass by, I used to suddenly stop and take my phone and take photos. You know, that ideas comes from nature only, actually. But again, I don't want to be imitated immediately, like what I see, right? So that's where the challenging comes out. So when I get inspired from, for example, those textures by road, even the water in the sagging water or mud in the floor or whatever. So that type of textures I like to inspire and to create those things in my painting. But again, I don't want to follow the same thing. When that's the reason. But I want to do a lot of in a way, you can say like a laboratory, do experiment and see because we have to see practically also. When you want to send the artworks in the roll format, whether the heavy texture will be, it will be withstand the residency of, the cracking, it will come when you roll, or you have to send as it is. We have to see all those things. We can't just anyhow only put our, thoughts in a painting, because we have to also see in other possibilities also, when the collectors buy, how heavy can they hang in their wall, and also the size matter. A lot of things I have to see. But again, the inspiration comes from nature, but the totally what I see, I don't want to be implement everything there. I have to see somewhere what to do and what not to do, all those things.
Yeah. Your art also talks about relationship, family, and there's a man-woman relationship. There's absolutely no nudity or vulgarity in your art, but you present it in a this particular bonding, a family bonding, in a very subtle way. So what is your theory behind presenting a relationship that way?
Relationship is very important, actually. Like bonding, relationship, family, husband, wife, lovers. That bonding is nowadays is slowly it's missing, with a busy life. So I try to, as an artist, I'm trying to bring those back through my painting to show to viewers that the bonding and closeness. That's why if you see my paintings, most of the paintings are tilted head like this, yearning for love, affection, closeness. And even the gesture, if you see, like, you know, that comfortable, you know, like very something they're expecting each other, they need each other, right? That type of closeness and feelings I try to express through my art, which all nowadays is, you know, with the busy life is not that much actively, you know, like we see in the daily life. And if you notice my painting also, I don't give a very direct eye contact in my paintings, in the my portrait, which I do. I try to minimize, you know, the lines and not more details also. So closing eye once again is when viewers see the paintings. If you open the eye like each other, we see that the message has been directly, you know, like is there. I don't want to give the direct message to the viewers. Let viewers be in part of my painting. Engage. I want to engage them, hold them. Though my painting, if you see, simple line only, but the emotion is hold there. No, I hold the emotion in that painting is actually. The same way, I don't want to give direct eye contact to the viewers also. Let viewers be in part of my painting and let them wonder whether it's happy or sad. Let them decide. I want them to be part of my painting and I want to invite them to be, you know, to hold and stand there and let them wonder what I'm trying to. That's why I don't want to give direct meaning also sometimes, you know, in my paintings, and I want viewers to be engaged in my part of my paintings and share their experience. And I like to, whenever in the art fair, sometimes even the gallery when I'm there, I don't tell when they're visiting the, you know, paint, they when visiting our gallery, I don't tell it's my painting. No, usually I just want to know what's their expression. If I say it's my painting, definitely they tell, you know, it's a nice, very nice, good, you know, all the things.
Yeah, that'll be very nice in front.
So I want to know the feedback, actually, you know, the real feedback, you know. That's the reason I don't share that immediately. This is, I'm the artist for this work, you know. When they come also, I want to ask them, how do you feel? What do you see in this painting? Some genuinely they tell, no, it's very sad for me, you know. I see it's very sad. Oh, okay. No, that type of feedback I want, actually, you know. And same collectors, after a few years, they'll come and see, you know, something is telling that, you know, they're expecting, they're, you know, yearning for something, or they're, you know, eagerly waiting for something, you know. Then that meaning slowly changes. When they're part of that, you know, artworks and they are engaged there and see daily, and it gives different meaning. That's the reason, one of the reason also, I don't put the eye contact and finish that meaning, that's it, no. I want to keep it close.
Yeah. So that you don't want to make it obvious.
Let be them and give different meanings and different opinion. I'm happy to know that, actually, in fact.
So you're basically putting a seed.
A client from Australia, she was in a gallery. I got this experience, actually. She was standing out in the window display. There was a painting in the window display and she was waiting outside. And I asked my manager to, you know, invite her inside. No, why is she standing long there for many? Few more minutes she was standing there. I was seeing that. No, she came and said, sir, she's crying. Why? No, you just bring him her. You want water, anything, have a seat like that. And I was asking her what happened, why. That's what, she's from Australia, but she connected my painting that I never visited that place that time. And she's telling, she got memory of something of her childhood memories. And there was a baby cloth was hanging and a mother was sitting there. So something, painting was similar, like mother concept, you know. And she can connect that one. And she was, somehow it's affected her, right? Some feeling somewhere, something is affected that. Like that 2-3 instant, I can say, the collectors were, you know, I touched their heart in some way, you know, something like that. The emotional was there. So more than my painting selling, I like this type of, you know, like somehow I'm connecting that, you know, I'm giving that emotional feelings to the viewers. That's very important. And I felt very happy, even though I sold a higher price that painting, but that was not my... You know, the happiness was that I can connect with someone.
Yeah, these testimonials, these experiences actually make a lot of difference than the value, yeah, that comes. So we have some more questions. Thank you, Sunita Agarwal. She is giving a compliment saying that most honest interview.
Thank you,
Sunita. Yeah, we have Gnanishan Prabaharan. He says, sir, thank you for sharing the lovely experience. Sir, what's your message or personal guidance for emerging artists in terms of selecting the subject and thought process in bringing them visually?
Selecting process, you actually, as an, you know, like beginners, you be genuine to, you know, don't worry about, you know, what sells, you know, you don't follow the market, whatever, you know, the artists are selling, then immediately we try to do those type of style. To be, you know, what that's why I said, whatever you do, whether you're a photographer, musicians, or you know, a dancer, whatever you do, do something nobody else can do, that, you know, something different actually. So you have to be, first of all, you don't go to the art material shop to buy the canvas and the art material shop, I have to say personally. So you want to be something different, you go to the hardware shop, try something like, you know, like a normal, you know, like what you get in the hardware, like paints and different brush. Even if you don't have brush, try to get some sponge and something, you have to experiment differently. Then only you can be different than others, what they do usually, you know. Once we decided, like, you know, this person is selling, no, why don't you do that type of subject? Maybe, you know, usage of the color or a subject. So you may be, that time you will be interested for you to go, but halfway then you go, you'll stuck there. Then you'll come back. Then again, you will follow the other artist, you'll go and you'll come back. But you won't be happy also, no. Basically, you should be, as an artist, you should be very happy of what you're creating. Whether it's, you know, you're doing, you do for yourself first. Don't worry about the collectors. Collectors, definitely, if it's genuine, you know, keep your name clean, do your artwork very, you know, like happily, and, you know, the subject, what you like, automatically everything will follow you, and, you know, the gallery will be looking for you, as I said. Something you have to be different than others. We can't, that's one of the reason I said, don't go for the art material shop first, if you want to be different. You know, that's what I know, like, few artists in India also, no, they have this type of things. They don't get materials from art shop. They go for hardware, even the brushes, colors, and paint. Experiment yourself, no. Do a lot of experiment and do something different. Even canvas, don't worry about canvas. Do plywood and do the metal, aluminum sheet. And how to create the textures, tones. No need to be like, you know, make it very simple. If you follow somebody, it will be really, it will be, won't be enjoying, you know, you'll be stressed. Actually, art is more to be, to lesser your stress level, actually, not to be increase your stress, right? So to do that, you have to enjoy first, you know, what you're doing. So it can be any subject, whatever, it can be figurative or with any medium, acrylic oil, it can be abstract acrylic oil, or it can be mixed media. For example, I like to do a lot of mixed media, right? So if you notice that my sculptures also, though the subject is bronze, for example, Krishna sitting in the cow, I don't leave it as that is only, that is for me only a subject. That is not a complete artwork for me. So apart from that, I'll try to add what are the things like mixed media, like using bricks or like, you know, like wood. And based on that, I used to do like recycled materials, whatever I found medium, like rusty things. So the works continue again and again. It's not like, though for me, some artists, maybe Krishna and cow finished ready subject, bronze, that's it, right? Krishna can keep a title like Krishna and the cow like that. But I'm looking beyond that subject actually, what to be adding. So that's where like uniqueness comes, right? Different from others. The subject's not finished with Krishna and cow. When I'm going to add with, just now you're telling about cosmic piece, which we'll be talking later also. So those cosmic pieces also, I want to be, I'm taking something from the, what I see in the earth. But visually, I'm giving visual impact like universal, no? Something is more, what imagination, like giving spirituality by adding certain materials and different vision, different visual impact actually, to know those sculptures. I'm not stopping with what, like exactly like a subject of Krishna and cow. So that's where like, you know, different we have to see. That's what you're asking, right? That, whatever we do, as I said, like nobody should do better than you. That's the simple, you know, concept.
So do you want to stress a bit more about the cosmic series?
Cosmic series is again like, as I just now mentioned to you about that, no, like I started with the painting 2D and with a cow. Mm-hmm. I started with the monochrome actually. Monochrome means like two colors with very light tones, very soft tones, you know, like using soft brush to create like smooth feelings. When you touch the canvas, it's no texture. Only the canvas texture will be there. Otherwise, the painting is very smooth. So slowly then I move to colorful. Then colorful adding with more colors, bright colors. Then what to do next? No, the journey, because I want the journey of, you know, don't want to stop with only one series, right? I was keep moving. And next was more color, what to do. Then I was thinking about adding fabrics. Fabrics means a lot of bright colors of fabrics, cut and paste. Then heavy texture in that same subject. The subject is cow only, but I'm using the subject cow and experiment different mediums and, you know, to go with the different level of, you know, the process to show. Because how long will be like 15 years with the same cow subject I know I have to, you know, I have to challenge myself, but I didn't move out with the, with my subject actually. The relationship theme with cow and human beings with the nature was there, always there. But the usage of, you know, the techniques was more, you know, the colors all, I want to show difference, right? So fabric, then again fabric, what to do? And that something like 2D was trying to do like a sculptural effect in the painting self projection, you know, like heavy textures, all those things. After that, what to do again? That's where I come back to sculpture. From 2D, I move to 3D. Same subject, cow. So in cow, I want to see all the angles. You know, all the angles. In the painting, you can't see the only the, no, like flat surface, right? In the 3D only, you can see the, all the angles. So then I started to do cow in bronze. By again the, doing that bronze, I want to go further development. That's where cosmic piece started in my mind. No? It was thinking, I was thinking how to add in more materials, which is my engineering. It was helped me a lot actually because of the materials, right? Those things, welding, all the things. I started to mix media by adding wood, like wood with bronze, concrete with the bronze, base with no, different, you know, like found medias and you know, car parts and the, and you know, like even sometimes I go and buy some fresh materials and add in, make it that is in that fresh material into like an old look. All this thing changes and try to combine together. And I used a lot of computer parts to, you know, give that depth. If you see the computer parts, is spray and it gives the to and fro depth there, inner out, all those things. So I add in those computer parts also in the bronze, and I created you know, like the cosmic piece, which is something very universal, which can't see, I can't relate it to it actually, you know. So something like illusion things, there but not there, but subject is there. But if you notice, my subject Krishna and cow will be there, but again surrounding all those things are illusion things, you know, like cosmics, like something very universal, you know, look I want to create it. And that's what that series has been created actually. After that, then again I want to show in the sculpture more colorful. Then that's where again I went to the recycled materials. So recycled materials of more on like car parts, two-wheeler parts, because already the paint is there, no, like quality paint. For example, in the cars, they would have been, you know, sprayed with good quality paints, and I take that those type of engines and car parts, windows and everything, and for example, that bumpers and also that Hero Honda tank, all those things I combined together and made more colorful. You would have seen there larger than life size cow with more colorful no, things. So again, because I want to keep changing and moving on my, you know, journey. That's where all this happened. When I think what would next, then it automatically, the materials comes based on my thoughts. And again, when I said, like, pick up the materials for certain reason and in the studio change for other reasons also. So we you fixed yourself and planned everything. This is what I want to do. I feel there's no enjoyment as a creator. As a creator, you want to have that, you know, don't fix yourself. Don't fix yourself when you want to do something and enjoy in your field, whatever you want to create. So leave it at the moment and go with the process and enjoy in that moment. And the process you have to enjoy, not the what is outcome.
Superb, sir. Thanks a lot. When we have compliments also, Sandhya Vadwani, she is basically complimenting that you are, you know, her mentor, feeling so great.
Thank you, Sandhya.
Seeing you live. So the last question from my side is, if one of your paintings go viral, okay, so, you know, it's a hit, one of your paintings maybe with the Krishna and the cow behind goes viral, and a lot of people like women use it for mug gum in their blouses and, you know, on their saris, on the curtains and all that, would you feel happy about that it's gone viral and, you know, people are using, you know, to wear it and, you know, using it commonly? Or would you start thinking of copyright, you know, how can somebody use it without my permission? So what will Mr. Gnana do with such situation?
Actually, before going to the answering to your question, also I have this experience in my own, you know, because I used to teach art, right? So when I teach art, I can't go beyond my style, you know, when I'm teaching also, right? It will somehow, even though I'm trying to stop my technique or my style, when I teach it, automatically it appears to my, you know, when I'm teaching actually. So those type of style also, some of my students to adopt, because they want to practice, they will take that type of style and they want to do it, right? and they create similar concept of how my head tilted or you know the closed eyes. So when they display or they share in the social media or anything, immediately the some of the friends or somebody will comment also, no, it looks like you know Jnana's works like that. So in a way, for the artist, for the beginners, it's okay to copy your masters or your mentor or whoever you know you think it's good, but you have to come out from that zone actually, you know, like once for practice is okay for you know, so for learning purpose, then after that you have to search for yourself, you know, what who you are and what you like and anything like the same way. But coming back to your question, so I'll be happy only, you know, like if they use my style and you know see for the project or anything like for their own creations, they're adapting my subject or the colors or what my style, I'm okay with that. I'm happy.
So thanks a lot.
For no copyrights. They no can enjoy.
You wouldn't think of that. Yeah, because I see a lot of art, you know, which are like converted, very senior artists later, their style is converted. A lot of ladies try to wear it. And, you know, the artists who do a common magam work, who are across the street and, you know, smaller towns and all that. They're so passionate about this work because they will go ahead and stitch it. Whatever painting, they would actually take like hours together and stitch it on the fabric. So, yeah. And I was thinking, you know, does copyright apply? And, you know, what does the original artist think about?
Copyright is there actually. Artists, you know, copyright is there. But, you know, it's certain reason, right? Like, for example, the photograph, somebody's photograph, they use that one to create a painting as it is. Then we have to at least tell the artist, right, that I'm inspired by your photograph. I'm using this for my painting. If the artist agrees, okay. If known, you know, sometimes it happens. Copyright is definitely there. We have to, you know, mindful on that. We can't anyhow take somebody's style and, you know, do for certain things. But unless if artist is okay with that and he don't mind, it's fine. If some artists, they don't like that, no, that which their creation or what they created to be used for certain purpose, which they think it's not good for market, like for the artist growth or whatever, then they have to respect their feeling also.
So thanks a lot for taking time out, sir. I mean, I would say didn't even realize the time. And, you know, I think, you know, the audience are also enjoyed this particular show. Good feedback. Kranti, thanks a lot for saying that it's a real open talk with true heart. I think that's the conversation we were trying to have here. Nirakar Chaudhary is saying very true and honest answer. I think he's referring to the last question which I've asked. But thanks a lot for joining in from Singapore, taking time out for this and, you know, giving responses in a very detailed way. Well composed. I think your state of mind basically gives us such a ease to have this conversation with you with no stress. It is an open conversation. I'm sure all of your students who are learning from you have a similar experience because that's very important. You know, the journey is very important than the end result. So I really love this conversation and
Our conversation is the same like my painting, no? It's happened then and there, not pre-planned. That's why. And also I like to thank Mr. Ravi and also Snehaji for giving this wonderful opportunity and also all the participants and giving like a positive feedback. Thank you once again, everybody.
Thanks a lot, sir. And thank you for Snehaj for providing a chance for me to speak to eminent artists across the world and, you know, doing this particular art talk. So friends, whoever is watching this, do follow this art talk. We plan to do a week, once in a week or twice in a week and, you know, bring upcoming eminent artists on this particular show. Again, this is more for knowledge sharing, more to learn from other artists, as Mr. Jnana also mentioned. Competition is good, but you know there are a lot of learnings which you can do from other artists, and never get into confidence that you're best, and you know the learning has stopped. So you know that's the whole purpose of this particular art talk, that we learn from every experience, every talk, and the conversations here. So thanks a lot, audience. Thank you, sir. Have a great day, and someday we will definitely meet up.
Thank you. Thank you.